My God is never wrong. See, I am just as nutty to think that if God was here right now and in here walks in a cat and God makes a mistake and calls that cat a dog, I believe that in that instant, that cat becomes a dog because my God is never wrong. It's an impossibility for him to be wrong. Do you know he's done that in the Bible before? Do you know that? He says, Isaac? No. What's the name? Jacob? Jacob, swindler. You shall no longer be called Jacob, but you shall be called Israel. Sounds pretty, right? It wasn't that pretty. That whole transition required effort from Jacob. See, Jacob met someone on the way going to go see his brother. See, his brother promised him that when his father died, he was going to kill him. So here he is on the way home to go meet with his brothers. And he had his own earthly plan. And he sent servants, go ahead of us. And when you see my brother, tell him all that you see belong to your brother, but he's given it to you. And then after all the cattle, he began to send his family. And he sent one wife, you know, Leah, the one that had crooked eyes. God has a sense of humor. Why didn't he leave that out of the Bible? Why would he put that she had crooked eyes? I wonder. See, God wants you to know that everything in the Bible was not all perfect. It wasn't all pretty. It wasn't all great. It doesn't say crooked eyes in the Bible. It says she had weak eyes. She was cross-eyed. That's what it means. So he woke up in the morning and he had been with his brand new wife and look at her and she can't see one person. She says two because she was cross-eyed. So he sent his cross-eyed wife with all her children. When you see my brother, tell him that you're his servant. But while his servants and family started to walk, he met a man. And he began to wrestle with that man. He says, I am not willing for you to go until you bless me. I'm not letting you go until you bless me. I'm grabbing a hold of you. Now, according to the word of God, they did that the whole entire night. I have really strong hands, but to stay holding something the whole entire night, do you know what a level of cramps your hands will have to experience just to stay holding something or someone? And he held on. And that angel says, I need to go. The sun is coming. You got to let me go now. That angel put his hand upon the largest muscle on the human body. That's all he did. Put his hand. And all of a sudden, he was marked for the rest of his life. He was marked from one touch. See, we all want to be marked by one touch of God, right? But don't really get the way we want it. Because see, he was marked by one touch. And for the rest of his life, everyone saw where he was touched. He walked with a little limp. Because he spent some time with God. Says, I am going to change your name because you have strived with God and lived. We want this instant faith. We are the Burger King generation. Have it your way. For God is not a have it your way God. God is have it my way God. See, God didn't create us so we can tell him what to do. I've heard people pray in church, and I think I told you this a week ago, and they'll tell God, you know, this person deserves it. Do you know, according to the word of God, what we deserve? Anyone in here, according to the word of God, do you know what you deserve? See, we are so American that we're used to saying, hey, I deserve this. I'm an American citizen. But see, the word of God says this, all your righteousness, and includes mine, are nothing but filthy rags. Filthy. We don't usually use the word filthy, so I have to do a verbal picture. You ever seen someone throw up? You have? You ever seen someone cleaning up with a rag? That's that rag. That's what God says we all are. We can't go to God, I deserve this. Not even when we've done everything right, we are still filthy. See, I only get what the grace of God gives me because I don't deserve it. I don't deserve to have been able to come to this nation and be able to be educated, have five kids, and have so many cars that we can leave some parked in the yard. See, I didn't deserve that. Someone somewhere lied to the people in this nation that said, you know, you deserve it. Well, what happened to Ethiopia? What did they do that they don't deserve it? What about Senegal or Nigeria? What about the Hutus? And I mean, anyone that you can think of that's having it really, really difficult, what did they do to deserve their situation? We were just born here, some of us, I wasn't. We were born here by God's grace. God gave us something we didn't deserve. And we have attitude. I tell our musicians, our young musicians, I want y'all to have attitude. I want y'all to be full of attitude when you play. I want to hear your attitude in your instrument. Play with boldness. See, it would be okay if we had attitude and our attitude was godly. God is looking for those attitudes. See, Jesus went into the temple. He had an attitude. He walked in and no, that's not happening. No, that's not happening. No, that's not that's not happening. That's not happening. He began to just throw things all around. Could you see Jesus having an attitude in the temple? I can. See, I know we can't see him because we got this little wimpy image of Jesus, all skinny and scrawny. He was a carpenter. Wait, he wasn't our kind of carpenter. Our kind of carpenter just does stuff with wood. He wasn't that kind of carpenter. He was, I'll build your whole entire house from floor on up. He was that type of carpenter, the one who'll carry the big old boulders to the spot because he's doing a foundation. He was that type of carpenter. He wasn't all skinny and scrawny. I think he was buffed. You know, I can follow the story in the Bible and kind of prove to you he wasn't skinny and scrawny because no one beat him up. You imagine you doing your little business and I come up and just toss your table all over, doves flying all over the place, sheep all bleeding all over the place. Why no one try to hit him? Come on, follow it with me. Why no one beat him up and he's whooping them? He wasn't no wimpy person. He was a strong man. He was a real man's man. And here we are. I deserve this. No, you don't. Father, you say you'll provide. Wait, you're starting to talk my language now. I think you're talking faith. That is faith, isn't it? He's not telling me what he deserves. He's telling me who I am. See, you want to know how to pray? Pray how God is. We did that little diddly today, our God is good. That's a good way to start praying. Lord God, when I fail, you're still always good. When I come to the end of myself, I discover you were there all along. Begin to tell God about his character, not what you think you deserve. I know when we get this trip over with. See, right now we know that Erica is going. She has a way paid, and it's no big deal because Erica's going. She went to the last one. I remember the last one. She was fretting. She was trying to grab hold of enough faith to get there. And then it was a done deal. Do you know she didn't do any of that this time around? She kind of already know what God will provide for this. He provided for the last one. He'll provide for this one too. There was no fretting in there. But see, I even watched her. She's going to school. How many of you knew she was going to school? The first semester she went to school, she was fretting. Now she has faith for what she's going through. So some of us, oh, why is this so hard? It's never easy to start something. We all want to get to the finish line, but how many never finish? How many start and stop, and start and stop, and start and stop, and start and stop, and start and stop? Come pray for me for what? So you can start again. I already know where that's going to go. I don't want to pray for you so you can start. Well, why not, Pastor? You've done that before. I need to pray for you to stop. Go all the way to the end and stop. Go through it and stop. Not stop in midway. I'm tired. So tired. How many of you remember your senior year in high school where you're like, I had enough of this? How many of y'all remember that? It's like you get to that senioritis, and you're like, I'm so sick of this. I can't take this anymore. I'm so tired of doing homework. I'm so tired of showing up to school. Why am I doing all of this? And if you remember, some people stop. And they dropped out. Now that we're older, how horrible is it to stop when you almost reach the end? You just had like 3 more months to go, and you stopped. Now you got to get a GED. Well, you know, that is life. No, that's not life. That's you. Well, how do I keep going? You add on to your faith, wisdom. You add on knowledge. You add on. See, we want to stop at just faith. But the Bible says that even after faith, you add on. You add on. You don't stop and say, I had enough. You add on. As crazy as it seems to me. See, some of y'all think I've lost it. I know because you've told me. I don't know how y'all live like that. I don't know. I look at y'all like y'all crazy. I don't know how you don't. Because if it's working for me, don't you think it's going to work for you? The word of God says that God is no respecter of persons. In other words, you can't pray. Oh, that happens to pastor, but that's pastor. You know, he prays a lot. You liar. I do not pray that much. Yeah, I know I don't sound like normal pastors who sit there and say, I wake up in the morning and I fast and pray till the afternoon. No, I don't. I don't. I don't do that. I wake up and my prayers are very short. I don't pray long, humongous prayers and sit there and pray for everybody. And when I tell you I'm going to pray for you right after I said I'm going to pray for you, I pray for you right there so I won't be a liar next time I see you. See, that's our doing. And sometimes you say, pray for me. What do you want to pray for? Oh, well, just, you know, just pray for me. Father, whatever she needs, provide whatever she needs. Short prayer. And not all, thou who are great and awesome, whom live in eternity, whom angels surround and rainbow clothe your crown. Forget all that stuff. Dad, I need you to provide for her, please, because she asked me to pray. And Lord, I'm your son. Just do it just to let her know who I am in you. No big deal. No big deal. But here it is. We are supposed to be the ones who are praying for others, always asking for prayer ourselves. Because we have not learned the fundamental things yet. What's fundamental about being a Christian? First of all, my God is good. My God is not the boogeyman waiting for me under the bed somewhere, waiting for me to mess up. That's not my God. My God is merciful. Father, I messed this one up, and I messed it up royally. Erase it, please. Let's do a do-over. Have you ever said that to God? Father, erase it, please. No, we don't do that. We feel guilty. We beat ourselves up. Sit there and just walk around with that. See, my kids, it started with Elijah. He was the first. Of course, everyone follows the pattern. Elijah gets sad. And when Elijah got sad, the shoulders would droop. The head would go down. Then we have Ariel. And Ariel, she'll get sad. The shoulders will droop. The head will go down. Now we have Lizzie. The shoulders droop. The head goes down. And then Elijah gets mad. Why are you doing that? She got it from you. She's following your pattern. We get into the church, and guess what we do? Our shoulders go down. Our head will droop. And how long shall we stay this way? How long shall we not know that we are victorious? Victorious people don't have their shoulders drooping and their heads on down. Do we not know that we are more than overcomers? This is not an overcomer position. This is a servant's position. This is a beggar's position. This is not a son of the living God's position. And we comment and look all beat up. Well, he's asking me to fake it. Yes, I am. Oh, yes, I am. You know, Jesus said that when you come in to take off the sackcloth, take off the ashes, comb your hair, and put some oil on your head. Didn't say come in here and let everybody know, I'm going through. Pray for me. Clean yourself up. Walk upright. Walk into the attitude you're supposed to have. If I'm a son of a king, you know what that makes me. I'm a prince. You think you're going to see a prince walking around like this? I think someone just took his kingdom, don't you think? We have to have a certain attitude. We messed up. Father, I messed that up. I am not going to pick that stuff back up again. Do over, please, but while we're doing over, clean it off of me so I don't stink. Not like how they do in churches. They'll do the little thing and then go back and get cleaned up and act like, I am so holy. And come Monday, hey, baby, I'm here to see you again. How are you? And come next Sunday, I'm so holy. Don't you know that the word of God says, whatsoever has been done in secret shall be shouted out from the mountaintop? Don't you know everybody's going to know your junk? Everyone's going to know it. What you going to do then? I'm going to be so embarrassed. Well, you need to have the attitude I'm embarrassed now so you can stop doing it. Let's get into the word. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Little kids used to sing this. Maybe we can learn the little song all over again. I wish I had more singers in here so we can do a round. I may try to do a round anyway, but we don't have our little kids. But see, it goes very simple. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Group 2, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Group 3. So, see, we can do a round out of that. We forget that the Word of God says we're supposed to rejoice. See, the enemy has been beating on you all week long. So you come to church and want everyone to know I'm beat up. But don't realize that you're beat up only because you don't know how to rejoice. See, I walk in places and people tell me you walk in with authority. Do you know I don't know that? I don't know I walk in an authority. I mean, I can have jeans and t-shirt and walk in. I can have jeans and t-shirt with a hole in my jeans and walk in. And I walk in with a certain attitude. And I've been told you don't walk with your head on down. And when people talk to you, you look directly in their eyes.
Since you don't go and jump back when someone says the wrong thing to you. You move forward. Said, how do you get that? I learned how to rejoice. Rejoice in what? When everything's going wrong. When everything's going wrong. Why would you rejoice when everything goes wrong? Because the world has its natural order. And according to the word of God, I'm not of this world. I don't need to follow the world's order. I am not of this world. I'm an alien. No, I'm not from Mars or Pluto or Saturn. See, when people come to this nation, they ask them for their alien card. I have my spiritual alien card. See, I don't belong to this kingdom. I come here as an ambassador of Christ. I come in and I have an attitude. You can't touch that. Why? That's my ambassador brief. You don't even have the right to open it. Give it back. There's a certain attitude, but you get it through rejoicing when you're going through stuff. You want for everything to be all right so you can rejoice then. That rejoice don't count. That's fake. Anyone can rejoice when everything is going right, but I want to see the idiot that rejoices when everything's going wrong. That's what the world will call it. You have everything going wrong, and you're sitting there, my God is good all the time. My God is good all the time. See, right now, you can see my wife and I, we're doing pretty good financially. We're doing well with our kids. So if I tell you to rejoice when everything is going wrong, you're looking at me with that look. I have Keisha sitting back there. She can tell you we've had moments where everything went wrong. When we have our daycare and the daycare, I'm paying in instead of the daycare paying back. But we didn't go in there with attitudes with those, boy, sit down, just be quiet. Your mama owes me money. We didn't do that, did we, Keisha? Come on in. You didn't bring him any lunch. He has nothing to eat. Keisha, do we have anything back that we can give this child? Okay, don't worry. We're going to give you something to eat. In the back of my head, she hadn't paid you in 3 months. My God is good all the time. And all the time, my God is good. It's not about this child. This child is a blessing. He's come here to be blessed so he can be a blessing. We get to lay our hands on these little kids while they're in here with us and let's bless them. See, we learn to rejoice. I was paying $70,000 a year every year for the daycare. Don't tell me I couldn't have an attitude. We learn to rejoice. We learn to rejoice in it. My wife went to a graduation with Donahoe, ran into the person we were leasing the property from. He owes us $11,000. My wife saw him and he jumped back. Whoa. Because, you know, he's paying for his child to be in private school, but he still owes us money. My wife didn't get, you scoundrel, you're no good friend. She didn't do that. She went up to him and said, hi, how are you? Scared the tar out of him. Sorry, choking on his food. You see what effect rejoice has? Don't you want to have some effect when you go somewhere? I was telling my kids yesterday that when you do good people who you do good to people who keep doing bad to you, according to the word of God, it shall be as coals of fire upon their heads. I'm like, burn, baby, burn. You messing me up? I'm going to start singing that song, Father. Let it burn. Let it burn. Let it burn. I'm going to keep on doing good. So why? That coal will get brighter and brighter and brighter. And I get in here and I'm like, it's hot, isn't it? Whew, it's hot. Why? Because I've learned to rejoice. I've learned to rejoice. When people persecute you and misuse you, what does the Bible says you are supposed to act like? Bless them. You're supposed to bless them. Oh, I can't wait to get even. Oh, they don't know me like that. Oh, they're going to know. I'm going to represent.
We start coming up with ways and don't know that we are going to reap those same attitudes that we are planting right now. We're going to reap that. Someone else is going to come and they're going to go back and they're going to get even too. And what do when someone else get even for all the junk we've done? I don't need no one to get even with me. I've done plenty of stuff when I was younger that all I need is God's grace. I need his unmerited favor. I don't need for no one to get even with me. I want to get to the point to where I can forget how much someone owes me. Do you know that if I have $1 million and I'm still thinking of someone who owes me $10, I'm going to be miserable? Can you see that? I mean, that's just misery. I got $1 million. I can't enjoy the $1 million because I'm contemplating the $10. See, I know I'm already preaching, because some of us, we have done that. God has given us so much, and we get run into somebody, oh, I remember I let her borrow $3. And she's in there spending all that money and won't even give me my, forget the $3. Move past the $3. You don't even need the $3. I was telling my wife yesterday, I said, honey, remember when we drove that big old green van and all we can put on gas was $5? You remember that? And she said, yeah, it will take us for a whole day. I said, honey, do you know that we will need $17 today to put what that $5 put? I'm glad that I'm not stuck on that $5 because it no longer can provide what that $5 provided back then. I need to move on up. Learn to rejoice. Rejoice. One of our youth was a little solemn yesterday. I said, hey, get happy. Enjoy it. When you start going through something, enjoy it. What? You mean that? Yes. Get enjoyment. If someone's talking bad about you, Donna, enjoy it. Because they won't be talking about you if you're not doing anything. Did I go above anybody's head? If you're not doing anything, nobody's going to talk about you. But you're doing something, someone's going to talk about you. Give them something to talk about. Man, I'm using a lot of songs today, huh? Give them something to talk about. Rejoice. And I will say it again. Rejoice. Don't just rejoice. Let me say it one more time. Rejoice. Don't you think that's important? Learn to rejoice. When people are making you mad, learn to switch it and laugh. My mom used to say it, and she had a broken English, and she said, you got to take badness and laugh. And she did. She was always being taken advantage of. And no one loved to laugh more than my mom. She laughed about everything. Now, I spend some time with the youth. The youth can tell you, Pastor likes to laugh. See, I have some times that you see me up here with tears in my eyes, but don't think that's how my life is. My life is not about tears in my eyes. I laugh a lot more than I cry. I've learned to enjoy whatsoever state I'm in. See, Paul said that. I've learned to abound, and I've learned to be abased. I've learned. How about you? Are you miserable where you are and haven't learned to enjoy the journey? See, we want to go to the next phase, but haven't learned to deal with the phase that we're in. Do you know there's no automatic pass in God? God will leave you there as long as you're there. See, while the people were in the wilderness for 40 years, do you know how long they were supposed to be in the wilderness? It was 11 days. Their journey was supposed to take them 11 days. It took 40 years. They were really slow, weren't they? I mean, on the real slow plan. Just walking around the desert. And then they have the nerve to blame Moses. It's your fault, Moses. You are not the only prophet here. We are prophets too. How many times they told Moses, Moses, tell God that we want to talk to him ourselves. And you think God says, oh no, I will only reserve the right to talk to you, Moses. God looked at Moses and said, tell them to come. Tell them to come. And tell them don't pass any further than this area or else I'm going to break out on them. Man, I wonder what that would have been like. Do you understand that God is saying, hey, I don't even break out on people. I allow my angels to break out. What would it be like if God broke out on someone? I don't even want to think of that. Cletus, can you think of that? Whew. There'll be nothing left. And all of a sudden they heard the sound and got afraid. And said, Moses, you can have it back, man. We don't want it. We'll just hear you. You talk to us. You go talk to God and you come talk to us. So we need to learn how to rejoice. When everything is going wrong, rejoice. Yes, things get good. But your rejoicing is not pure. It's not right if you can only do it when everything is right. Do it when everything is wrong. Keisha, you remember when we got the boys? It was hard to rejoice. I got to be honest with you. It was hard. Sorry. It was hard to rejoice. You know why? Because the kids did not have that natural food introduced to them at the right time. So they smelled all the time. You walk in the room and you know they're there. Because they had an unpleasant smell on. And it wasn't just like an aroma. It was thick. Walk in. Goodness gracious, I just came home and I already know they're here. That was hard. I hadn't even seen them. Already just walk in the door and have to prepare your mind. That's rough. I remember people telling us, you need to give them back. They're too much work. Give them back. But I also remembered driving to Walmart, having my three kids in the car, and saying, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Honey, we only have three kids, don't we? Yeah, we only have three. 1, 2, 3. We do only have three kids, right? Yeah, we only have three. We've only always had three since Lizzie was born. Honey, I feel like we're missing kids. The very next day, we had two more. See, I had to learn to rejoice from that one experience at Walmart until our kids started acting better. See, I had to learn this was God's plan the whole time. Now, sometimes for us to rejoice, we have to remember when you heard the promise. Abram lived on the promise he never got to see. We have to remember the promise and rejoice in the promise. You got a child that's a knucklehead? What promise did God tell you about that child? Every time you look at the child, remember the promise. It's the promise that brings you joy. It's not how they're acting right now. I have a 16-year-old, a 13-year-old, 2 8-year-olds, 1 6-year-old. I can tell you I am living many days on just the promise. Because I'm just as human as all of you. Get some days you just want to grab them outside the neck and poof. I'm living on the promise. Rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. Go to the next verse. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Let your what? Your gentleness. Your what? your gentleness. Man, I need to stay right here. Nice, nice breeze right here. It's getting warm. We used to have men called gentlemen. Y'all remember those days, ladies? Gentlemen had to act different from regular men, right? If the lady was cold, they had a jacket, they'll take their jacket off and put it on the shoulder of the lady. They go to a restaurant and they'll pull the chair out and pull the chair in. No, this wasn't formal dining. This was just in any restaurant. It was to open up the door, walk all the way to the other side of the car and open the door and wait till they get in and close the door and walk back around and get in the car. And that was called being a gentleman. The little extra things the guys did. The girl didn't do anything to deserve it. She was just a girl. Oh, man, he didn't say that, did he? Yeah, the men will hold the door for you even though they didn't know you. And now here it is telling you to be gentle. Well, if you don't know what it means, I just told you. Hold the door. I get an attitude when I hold people's door and they just walk in. Don't you get an attitude too? Am I the only human person in here? I get an attitude. They don't say thank you or anything. I used to say, you can at least say thank you. Goodness gracious, the day of slavery have been long gone. I would get an attitude. Now I don't get an attitude anymore. I hold the door and they walk by. I say, you're welcome, and walk away. I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to rejoice. They didn't say thank you, but I was gentle, so I said a response as if they said thank you. You're welcome. Walk out. I had someone come by. I am so sorry. My mind was somewhere else. I am normally not that rude. Thank you very much. But what if I fussed them out? What did I do? I wounded the person, but I'm supposed to be a Christian. For what? God wants us to learn to be a little more gentle. Be gentle with each other. I had a class on Wednesday with the youth, and we were talking about dating stuff. I said, if someone likes you, be gentle. If you don't like them back, I don't like you, boy, you're ugly. Be gentle. Let them off easy. Why? You might ruin them for him. The next girl, he might be afraid to even say anything because you said something that you shouldn't have. Be gentle. See, Ariel is at the age now where people are starting to tell her that they like her. And I am so grateful that she's learned to be gentle. I'm grateful. All of us need to be a bit more gentle. You have people that are coming to church and they're not acting like the way you want them to act. First thing, it's not your thing, it's God's thing. That's the first thing. It's not your thing, it's God's thing. Before you open your mouth to correct, be aware that when it's your turn, don't go out screaming here when someone else is correcting you. Whatever attitude you use to correct someone, that attitude is going to be used to correct you. Whatever you use to measure, that shall be measured back to you. I am not quick to correct people. What? No, I pray first. I pray first. I wait a little time. Why do you do that? Because I want the right time. I want the time that's going to be effective. I don't want to keep repeating myself over and over and over and over and over and over. I'm waiting for the right time. I do that with my kids too. I wait till the right time. Sometimes they made me mad and I blurted out, but you know, they're my kids. They're not ever going to get away from me. I'm going to always be their dad. But with the other people, I wait. Do you know some people have some issues that they've had all their lives and you think you're going to correct them in a moment? Come on, they've had it all their lives, and they run into you, and all of a sudden, oh, you can't do that. If they've had it all their lives, how long you think is going to take for them to get that fixed? And we're gentle. Baby steps. Baby steps. Oh, you took a little step. All right. And then the other people say, that's not nothing. She just took a little baby step. Whole life, baby steps. Baby steps. Just a little step here and a little step. Eventually, they're going to be taking big steps, and eventually they're going to be running with it. And eventually you who were criticizing would be left in the back. I've seen that happen over and over again. So we're gentle. Don't be so quick to try to fix people, because when it's your turn, don't get mad. I have watched our most critical people that we have in our church, we have a few, are the ones that you have to be the most careful with. You got to walk on eggshells with them, but then they never walk on eggshells with anybody else. So the Bible here is telling us, learn to be gentle. Be gentle. What is it going to take away from you? Keisha has been one of our employees, and I tell you, I've never lost it with Keisha. But neither did Keisha see me lose it with anybody else. And anytime there was a problem with a parent, I'm sure Keisha enjoyed it. You'll have to speak with Mr. Ronaldo when he gets here. I'm sure she got some crazy enjoyment, because sometimes she had to hold back and not say anything. And it was like, oh, I'm going to let you have it. But you have to wait till Mr. Ronaldo gets here. And when I got there, we'll go in the office and close the door. I didn't scream. Sometimes it was as easy as this. I am so sorry. It's not working out with you here. You're fired. Get your things. Thank you for at least trying. And the lady will come and get all her things and be all mad. And Keisha said, did you tell her? Well, I didn't need to. You didn't tell her? No, I told her she's fired. Well, why didn't you? Because she's fired. She's not coming here no more. She's walking out of here. We probably will never see her again. But you should have told her, why? We'll never see her again. Her time here has come to an end. That's enough. And seeing Keisha's learned to be gentle. There's no one that's more gentle with kids than Keisha. And she's around a whole bunch of ungentle people. That's where she works at now. Bunch of ungentle people. That does not produce something good. If I'm gentle and if I'm kind, then people will be gentle and kind to me. It doesn't mean that everyone will do it all the time, but the majority of people will do it. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Oh, the stress of life. Life is so stressful. Anxiety is where we derive our word stress from. And God said, don't be stressed out. Did I say it clear enough? Don't let that algebra test stress you out. Because it says, don't be anxious for anything. Be anxious for nothing. Well, I don't know how you did it when you were studying for your test. I did it this way. If they can get an A, I can get an A. You didn't stress out, I did not. When you had to do a test, you didn't stress, I did not. You're telling me you didn't stress when you had to take a test? I'm telling you, I did not. You didn't stress out when you were studying? No, I taught myself to relax. Well, why were you relaxed when you're studying? Because when you're stressed out, you can't learn. Need to relax. I want the information to come in, so I don't need to have dams blocking it. I need to learn to relax. God got this. Did y'all hear what I said? Now I got this. I'm in control of nothing. God got this. Relax. I'm not anxious. Have you ever paced the floor telling yourself you're not anxious? I did that. I remember doing that. My wife was in the delivery room with Elijah in 11 hours, and then they just told her she has to have a cesarean, and they put me out of the room to prep her, and I'm outside. I will be anxious for nothing. I'll 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 be and I'm telling you, it didn't work. I was still anxious. I was repeating the verse, but I was not living the words of the verse. The more I said it, the more anxious I got. And then I got mad at being anxious. And then I got a little quiet and said, Father, that woman in there, I love her. I want her to still be here after she gives birth to that boy. That little boy, I've never had the opportunity to meet him yet, but I love him too. So I want to see him too. And Father, I'm having a hard time not being anxious. And I know your word says to be anxious for nothing. And I know that I am wrong and you are right, but please help me not be anxious. What happens is a lot of times we do this little fake Christian thing. Oh, I'm not being anxious. You know, I just believe. No, you're not. You're being anxious. Well, I'm being a little anxious. You need to tell God. But, you know, everybody's human. Yeah, Jesus was 100% human too. And 100% God. He was human too. So when you hear the word, be anxious for nothing. You know when it's giving you time to have anxiety? Never. Never anxious. What does that feel like? Never being anxious. We have this trip to Jamaica coming up. Jennifer told me we need to do a deposit of $6,000 by this day. Okay, honey. Honey, we need 6,000. Yes, I heard you. Do we have 6,000? Yeah, we do. We have 6,000 already? Yes, we do. I have the bank account. I know how much money we have. And I said, I know how much money we have too. But you don't have the bank account. I don't need it. Why? He's never let me down before. Not going to be anxious of something that God can just do in a second. Y'all know how weird that is? That God could wait till the very last second. Here, put it on my credit card. Thank you, Jesus. But here we are pulling our hair out. I can't do it because I cut it too short. But just yanking it out in chunks, trying to make something happen that God says is going to happen anyway. Stop being anxious. Stop being anxious. What is causing our anxiety? Because, you know, I know we've been on this for a while. I got up this morning. I want you to know I got up this morning. And I already had some time with God, but God gave me nothing to talk about or preach about this morning. Absolutely nothing. Got up. Father, you haven't said anything of what you want me to speak of. They are your people. They are your sheep. This is your problem. I wasn't anxious. Even if I would come here and God gave me nothing, not anxious. Why? Because to bring forth a word, it's not my problem. Do you understand that? See, God don't want me to be even anxious of bringing a word from God. God can bring his word all by himself. I don't need to get all in the mix of it. I'm the one that's speaking the word he's given. So if he hasn't given a word, then maybe I have no word to give. And Jennifer and I were in the kitchen, and all of a sudden God spoke a verse, and I'm, oh, just got the message. Let me go into the computer. I don't know what we were talking about. We were probably talking about coffee or something. That's God's job. That's not my job. But what if I got anxious? Grab hold of my Bible and start looking for old messages I already preached. Oh, Lord God, what kind of pastor I am that I haven't even heard a word from you to give to your people, and I'm giving you stale bread. Oh, I know you didn't hear it. Bread that sat there for a while and got all hard and has no moisture because I have to give you something to eat. But the word says we're supposed to live of every word that proceeded. It is fresh bread. It is fresh bread. Can't be anxious to get bread. Like, Lord, it's your job. You bring forth what you want your people to hear. And today, we're in summertime. We're suffering through summertime anxiety. What are we going to do with our kids at home? How are we going to have them entertained? Where are we going to go? Where are we going to take them? We have to give our kids some fun during the summertime because, you know, they're going to go back to school and they haven't done anything. And, oh, we're going to look all bad and like bad parents. And we do all this crazy stuff that has nothing to do with anything. Because, see, I know the kids. We have kids right now that if I should say, you know what, we're going to go to the park. Oh, we're going to go to the park? Yeah, we're going to go to the park. We're going to the park. I haven't told them we're going to do anything. We could probably just go to the park and just sit down. But the idea of that we are going somewhere is enough for them. Not saying we're going to Disney World. We want our kids that we have to go to Disney World so they can have that I'm getting out of Alabama to go somewhere else. But it's not because we need to take them. We do all this nonsense and put all this pressure on us when we don't understand that all my kids want is to be where I'm at. Did y'all hear that? That's all my kids want. Dad, are you going? Well, I'm not feeling too hot. I'm going to stay home. Well, I don't want to go. Why do you want to go? Because you can't go. It's baffling to me to have my 16-year-old and my 13-year-old to want to be around me. My 8-year-old, yeah, my 6-year-old, I can see it. But I guess you never grow out of that. You always want to be around your parents. And what we do, we create all this anxiety. We had the Glens over for a night and said, I'm going to take you all to the pool. Yeah, we're going to the pool. Did a phone call. It's $10 a person. Father, thank you for providing. My wife did another phone call. I said, come back tomorrow. It's $2 a person. Girls, we're going to the pool tomorrow. We will not go to the pool today because that'll be $110. We'll go to the pool tomorrow. It'll be $22. Now, do you care? Do you think I looked at their faces when it dropped and said, oh, well, that's not right. You're going to have to come up with that $110 because you promised them. No, no. I easily say, tomorrow we will go. If they had an attitude, that'll be their problem. My attitude was rejoice. Because do you know how much money I saved? I'm like, hey, I'm taking you tomorrow. And we went the following day and got some water guns and sat there and played with everybody. And it's like, hey, now, if you haven't noticed, I play with my kids. So if some of you are like, well, my kids don't want to be around me, then maybe you need to start playing with your kids. Just be in there with them. And I play and I pull my muscle in the back because I grab hold of Elijah in the pool and just tossed him. And then they wanted to see how strong I was. So Adrian got on his back, and I grabbed Elijah and Adrian, and they're like, ooh, man, my dad is strong. See, I wasn't anxious. about whether I can come up with $110. When I heard $110, you know what I said in myself? Father, I'm sowing into good ground. I'm sowing into these kids. That's a good ground. But when God answered and said, you don't have to pay that, I made a way for you to pay $22 instead. Thank you, Lord God. You answer prayer without me even asking. God does not want us to walk around sulking. He doesn't want us to walk around with our shoulders drooping down and our head falling to the ground. God wants us to be aware that He is not the one that's causing us stress. We grab a hold of that ourselves. We invite Him in. Come on in. Would you like a seat? Would you want some tea and crumpets? We make it difficult for our own selves because it's easier to be angry than it is to be happy. It is much easier. Have you ever had someone do something wrong to you and you see them like 10 years later and it just pops right back? And you have to say, come, get off of me. You know, Jesus forgave me. I can forgive this person. I am glad that God has a sea of forgetfulness. By the way, God is not forgetful. He has a sea just so He can forget. Do you know how wide a sea is? God says He has a sea of forgetfulness. When we go before God and we've asked God to forgive us about something, and we go back and ask God to forgive us about that same thing God already forgave us, He don't even know what you're talking about. He said He has placed it into the sea of forgetfulness. And here you are, Lord God, you remember when I did this? And hey, open the books and see. What is she talking about? Wait. This said located at sea. Honey, I have no idea what you're talking about. We located that at sea. It is not in this account book. It is in the other account book, and that account book is not openable. There could be such a word. If there isn't, I just made it up. He's placed it in the sea, and here we are, battling some old stuff that has been forgiven. Some old junk. And here we are as pastors. And all those who are training pastors, we like to dig stuff up. Tell me about where you came from. Tell me about the last church you were in. Tell me about the relationship that you had with this. And tell me. And you walk in here and say, I don't want to know. The Bible says it's time that we know one another by the Spirit and no longer by the flesh. Whatever was fleshy about you, I don't want to know. Right now, all I want to know is what the Spirit says about you. And how we are walking around, are we trying to dig into people's flesh? Are we doing the same thing? Erica, tell me about your mama. What did your mama do to you? Tell me about your daddy. Tell me. Cut out that mess. You're going to find out stuff you don't want to know. You'll find out stuff you don't know how to deal with. Cut that out. Learn to deal people with the Spirit. Do you know when God says something, it's a done deal to me? Can we all get to that point? Can we all get to the point? See, I've seen miracles of things, not just miracles of, you know, healing. I've seen miracles of things enough to understand God can do what He wants to do when He wants to do. See, my wife, a few months ago, we got a jacuzzi tub, and, you know, we got into the jacuzzi tub, and she started venting, and the venting went like this. Every time I get a car, it ends up being your car, and I want a car of my own. We got the van, then the van ended up being your van. And we got the expedition, and the expedition became your expedition. And then we got the Mercury, and then the Mercury ends up being your Mercury. And I want my own car. And I want a small car. Lord God, you know I don't need this woman to nag me, right?
Can you give her her own car, please? And the next day, someone walks up to her right here at church with keys. I had a dream last night, and in the dream, you were in my car, and I saw your hair just flowing back in the wind. So I'm believing that God wants you to have the car. Here are the keys. Now, if it's you, you would have been screaming all over the place. So guess what my wife did? She screamed all over the place. All over the place she screamed. Because here is a nice car that's paid for. Just scream. Scream for her car. Wait. Why did God wait for us to have this conversation to just show out the next day? Don't you think all of that had a purpose? He already knew he was going to do this a long time ago. Why did he wait till then? You know why? So I can tell you that that's proof. I didn't all get all anxious. I went in the jacuzzi to relax. You know, I have the jets hitting me with hot water. I'm in there to relax. You're not going to stress me out. I'm here to relax. In other words, God, your daughter, you fix her. He got this. Learn to not be anxious, even if you are, because 90% of sicknesses are caused by anxiety. Even cancer has started because of anxiety. Don't you think that's important to know? Learn to relax. Whatsoever state you're in, if you don't have enough money to pay your rent and it's due tomorrow, why are you stressed out?
Because I don't have enough money and it's due tomorrow.
That's the time you need to relax and wait. Lord God, there's nothing I can do. It's all yours. Isn't that the right time? I had one of our pastors in Georgia, we spent the whole night talking over the phone. And she says, oh, man, it's 6 o'clock in the morning. I need to go to work. We've been talking all day. I mean, the whole entire night we've been on the phone. And I've been enjoying the presence of God on the phone. Now I have to go to work. And she's older than I am. So she's like, I'm hoping I'm not going to be all tired. I said, let's pray before we hang up. Father, let her body feel like she's rested all night. I ask in the name of Jesus. She called me back that night. You would not believe this. It's kind of hard when you pray for something and then people tell you you're not going to believe it. I worked all day and I didn't even feel tired at all. And I'm back home again and I'm still not tired. How did that happen? I'm like, I'm glad that it wasn't according to your faith because you'll be all worn out. When I began to pray, I saw you in my mind's eye. I saw you walking all day without feeling tired. Because when the Bible says that when you pray, believe that you have received it. I prayed it, I saw it, I walked it through with you. And even at the end of the day, I saw you calling me to tell me this. Anxious for what? For nothing. God doesn't want you to be anxious.